It's so great to see a full house of folks today. Glad that everyone's here with us. I know some of you got your family here with you, and that's an awesome thing. Last year at this same time, I was here, me and about two more people. Because of the COVID-19, we had to do a virtual Easter. So God's brought us through, hadn't he? He brought you through. He got you here. There's a reason why you're still living. God's not through with you yet. Turn in your Bible, if you would, with me to the book of Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. Brother Gene made mention of a cartoon he saw one time yesterday about a guy that only went to church with his wife on Easter and Christmas. And the caption underneath it said, "Why does a preacher always preach about Christmas and Easter?" Well, because that's when he went, right? It's hard not to come on Easter without me talking about what I'm going to talk about today, because that's what it's all about. We're going to talk about the very foundation of our faith. In Romans chapter 5, verse 6 through 8, is one of my favorite scriptures in the Bible. And it says, "You see, at just the right time, when we were powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." I had someone ask me one day, "Why did the Jews crucify Jesus?" I think we were watching the movie The Passion. And the person said, "It really angers me that they would do Jesus like that." And so I think that's kind of a common idea when we think about the crucifixion of Jesus. I mean, who usually gets the blame? Well, we like to think of Judas, of course. Judas was a follower of Jesus, and he betrayed Christ for 30 pieces of silver. Or we may think of the chief priest and the Sanhedrin. They falsely trumped up charges against him and made false witness. Or maybe we can think of the high priest Caiaphas. He was the one who eventually demanded that Jesus be taken to Pilate and that Jesus be turned over to him to be crucified. We often think it maybe was the Jews. After all, they had a chance to release Jesus. I mean, Pilate brought before them Barabbas, or Jesus, Barabbas the murderer, the thief. And Pilate asked, "Which one shall I release unto you?" And they screamed, "Barabbas." So maybe it was the Jews that crucified Jesus. Maybe it was Pilate. I mean, he's the one who gave the final order, even though he washed his hands. I mean, that was insignificant. He gave the final order that Jesus to be crucified. Maybe it's the Roman soldiers who beat and scourged him and who made him carry his cross up the hill called Calvary and who forced him down upon the ground and who put a nail in his hand and drove nails into his feet and his hand and who crucified him physically. Maybe it was the Roman soldiers. But the Bible tells us that someone crucified Jesus. Someone was the murderer. But the Bible tells us that if we want to find out who actually crucified him, we need to look into the mirror. Because you and I, we crucified Jesus according to the Bible. In the scripture we read this morning, I want you to notice a couple of things. It says, "Christ died for the ungodly." Christ died for the ungodly. Then later on it says, "While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You know, we like to think of ourselves as good people. That's not the case. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." In Romans 3, 10 through 12, talking about you and I, it says, there is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away. They have all together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. Every single one of us in this room know in our heart of hearts that we are sinners, that we blow it. I mean, we're not sinners on the fact that we mess up or that we make mistakes. We're sinners knowing that what we're doing is wrong and yet continue to do it anyway. And yet somehow we shake our little fist at God saying, God, why are you not good to me? After all, I'm so good to you. I mean, I lift up a bedtime prayer every now and then, and I read the Bible every now and then. I show up at church on Easter. Surely, God, you know I'm a good person. Mama may have told you you were good, but the Bible teaches us that sin is not a mistake or a mess up, that sin is anything unlike the character of God. Any thought, feeling, or action that we would have that God wouldn't have is sin. Any thought, feeling, or action that we do have that God wouldn't have is sin. Today we're going to talk about the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that word gospel means good news. And today I want to ask you, do you know the good news? But before you can understand the good news, you got to understand the bad news. The good news is, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That's the good news. Well, we don't read on after John 3:16 to John 3:17 and John 3:18, where the Bible says, where Jesus is saying, who does not believe is condemned already because you have not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. What does it take to send you to hell? Nothing. You're already on your way without Christ. You're already on your way. We're born in sin. It's called original sin. You were born in sin. Our very nature is inclined to sin. We're like pigs drawn to mud. We're humans drawn to sin. And all of us sin. All of us sin and fall short of the glory of God. The Bible also teaches us in the book of Romans chapter 6, verse 23, that there's a cost to sin. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. Our sin brings death. Our sin brings death to us. Our sin brings death to relationships. Our sin brings physical death. We know that, but it also brings spiritual death. It brings emotional death. It brings relational death. But also it brings death to us between our relationship with God. You know, we've heard so often, God loves us, and that's true. God does love us. But if we were to appear before God in our sinful state, his holiness demands justice. And the law says this, the wages of sin is death. And it's talking about death there. It's not just talking about spiritual death and emotional death and relational death and physical death. It's talking about the second death in the book of Revelation. Now, I'm old school. I still believe the Bible is the word of God. And in old school, they talk about hell. And that's what second death is. Second death is an eternity in the lake of fire. Now it talks, you know, the Bible says that good people don't go to heaven and bad people go to hell. That's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches that all of us, that there's none of us that are good. And so therefore, without Christ, every single one of us are one heartbeat from hell without Christ. We all are, because none of us are good. You can't use the excuse, well, I tried my best. I have a good heart. You see, I'm a good person. That's not true. Not according to the Word of God. The Bible calls us evil, liars, hypocrites. I'm sorry to burst your bubble. You're not a good person. I'm not either. Because all of us are sinners, and all of us fall short of the glory of God, and because of that, there's a cost. There's a cost. The wages of sin is death. But here's the good news. The good news is that while you were yet a sinner, Christ went to the cross and died for you. Do you understand this, people? I mean, Christ didn't look down and see Judd doing his best. He looked down and saw Judd and Wade Wallace doing his worst. He saw us in the most hideous, despicable sin that we've ever committed. He saw us doing things that were totally contrary to what God wants us to do. Things that were destroying our own lives and destroying the lives of our kids. He saw that. He saw the deepest, darkest secrets you have in your heart that you don't want anybody else to ever find out. And God saw that. Nobody else may know that, but God knows that. God knows exactly what you were thinking, exactly what you did, and exactly why you did it. And as God looked at that hideous sin that we try to have covered up, that we hope to take to our grave, as God looked at that, the Bible says that while he looked at that, he chose to love you in spite of you. He chose to go to the cross and die in your place. I want you to notice that demonstrates is a present tense. And that Christ died in the past tense. You know that? I mean, we're talking about when did Christ die? Well, we think, well, Christ died 2,000 years ago upon that cross, right? But yet it says God demonstrates. It doesn't say God demonstrated. It says God demonstrates his love for us that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So what's that saying? It's saying that today, if you give your heart and your life to Christ, as God looks past time, he sees at that moment Jesus dying just for you. Do you realize that if you're the only person to ever come to Christ, Jesus would have went to the cross and would have died in your place? Jesus didn't die for the world. My friend, Jesus died for you. You. Who crucified Christ? You and I did. Now the Bible tells us in John chapter 10, verse 18, Jesus talking about his death says it this way. He says, no one takes it from me, talking about his life, but I lay it down on my own accord. The Bible also says in John chapter 15, verse 13, greater love has no man than this, than a man lay down his life for his friends. You see, you have to understand, my friend, Jesus did not have to die. Jesus chose to die. He did not have to go to the cross. He did not have to die. He chose to die. Imagine what it must have been like the day they crucified Christ. Jesus had told his disciples, he says, when the disciples debated with him, disputed with him that he was going to have to die, Jesus says that he would die. Jesus said, I choose to lay down my life. Could you imagine what heaven must have been like that day? Because Jesus had told his disciples, I could call down 12,000 or 12 legions of angels, 10,000 angels. At any moment, Jesus could have called them down. And I can imagine that day in heaven, what it must have been like. With all the angels decked out in battle gear around the throne of God. And Michael, the high angel of God, the archangel of God, standing beside the throne of God, waiting simply on the command. Because Jesus had all of heaven, all the legions of angels at his command. He could immediately call them and stop the madness, but he didn't. I can imagine Michael as he stood by the throne of God and they saw as they took Jesus out. As a Roman soldier stripped the clothes off of his back, tied him to a pole, a Roman soldier behind him with a cat of nine tails, a whip made of bone and metal, intertwined in the leather. The Roman soldier bringing the whip back. And lash after lash across the back of Jesus, digging into his flesh, shredding his flesh. Michael, the high angel of God, standing beside the throne of God, saying, God, God, let us go. God, what has he done? Surely, God, you're not going to let him die. Then after the beating, they drag him out. Golgotha, the place of the skull. As he bore his cross up Calvary, I can imagine Michael looking at God and saying, God, why? Why? Surely, God. Surely. Surely, God. You're not going to let him die. A crown of thorns placed upon his head. Beaten beyond recognition. As they throw him to the ground. The crowds gather around as they stretch the hand of Jesus out and place it upon that wooden cross beam. I can imagine Michael looking at God and saying, God, God, what has that hand done? God, why? The hand that had taken a couple of fish and bread and fed thousands, the hand that had touched the lame and they could walk again. And mourning and said, child, arise, and the words were barely spoken when she opened up her eyes. And yet they took that hand, and the Roman soldier's shadow covered the agony on the face of Jesus. As the Roman soldier brought back the hammer, and the hammer fell with an explosion across the valley. Surely, you're not going to let him die. And then they lifted him up, and they took his feet, and they placed his feet against the tree. And a Roman soldier took a nail, and he placed the nail into the feet of Jesus. And I can imagine Michael saying, God, why? Why? What have those feet done? Feet that were firmly planted in a boat, standing and grabbing the mast against a raging storm, and with a word calming the seas. Feet that had walked on the water to reach his disciples when in distress. Feet that had walked the hot sands of Galilee with one message, you can be forgiven though you are a sinner, though you have strayed from God. You can be born again. You can be forgiven. You can begin life anew. And yet the hammer fell on the wooden nail. And they laughed at him as he cried for them. Jesus wasn't hung on a cross with a loincloth draped around his waist. Jesus was hung from a cross, exposed, naked, for all to see. They laughed at him. They mocked him. Come down from the cross, and now we'll believe. Just come down. He saved others. Can't he save himself? And I can imagine Michael saying, God, let us go. Let us go. And Jesus looked at this mocking multitude. And instead of unleashing the angels, said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Then the Bible says, Jesus, in a loud voice, cried, Eli, Eli, Sabachthani, which translated, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? For that day, your sin and my sin were placed upon the back of Jesus. They took him down from that cross in the rain. And they put him in buried him in a borrowed tomb. They rolled a stone in front of that tomb. And the world said, it's over. And as they buried him in that tomb, Roman soldiers guarded that tomb to make sure that no one entered and no one left. They guarded it with their life. But 3 days later, Jesus rose from the dead, proving not only is Jesus one who says he's God, my friend, Jesus is God. And this God, Jesus, reaches out to you today. This God who knows all things, this God who created a wonderful and marvelous universe, this God who raised himself from the dead, this God knows your name. He knows your name. And today, if you will commit your heart and life to Christ, you can rest assured that the wages of your sin is death, but it has been paid. Your sin debt has been paid. Is this good news to you? Is this good news to you? You see, right now, all we hear is bad. But today, God offers us good news.
2 days, 3 days in past. Despising God.
God demonstrated his own love to us, to you, in this. While you were yet a sinner, Jesus went to the cross and he died in your place. He loves you. He loves you. One of the first songs I learned as a child was "Jesus Loves Me, This I Know." For the Bible tells me so. He doesn't love me because I'm good. He loves me because he loves me. He just chooses to. And right now, you think you're lonely. You think you're going through too much. You don't think you can ever overcome. God knows what you're going through. And God knows your struggles. And God wants to walk through this life with you. And you can leave here today knowing God that you're forgiven. You can leave here today knowing that you've given your heart and your life to the care of him. He loves you so much. What good news. That while we were yet sinners, Jesus went to the cross and died. I'm going to ask you this morning to pray a prayer, something like this with me. Dear God, Lord, I'm a sinner. You know I am. I am wrong and I've done wrong. But God, you chose to love me. I give my heart and my life to you this morning. Jesus, you died in my place. Today I'm going to live for you. I give you my heart, I give you my life.
My Savior, Lord.
Thank you for loving me. Thank you for saving me.
Because he
lives. If today you are saved and you know it, you know that you've been born again, you know that Jesus died in your place, and you've experienced his love and forgiveness, I want you to slip up your hand as a testimony to me. Amen. So many. Yet there were so many others that couldn't. Today you can know. You can know that you've been born again. All the old can be wiped away. You become a new creature in Christ today. And I'm going to ask you, wherever you are, to step out in just a moment. I'm going to ask you to come forward. And I'm going to ask you to come forward. It's nothing magical about coming. It's just about your coming, saying, today I'm giving my heart to Jesus. All I'm going to do is I'm going to pray with you and for you as you begin this new journey. We're going to let this invitation play. And as it plays, you step out right now and you come on. For others of you who've been born again but have backslid all the way to God, today's a good day to come home. Won't you come right now?